when I was at my bottom, when I was so miserable and so spent, I used to like open my eyes in the morning and I would be like, fuck.
Welcome to Self-Made and Sober. I'm your host, Andrew Lassise, with selfmade-coaching.com. And in this podcast, it's my job to interview people who are not only crushing it in business, but have also struggled with addiction in the past and are in long-term recovery. Be sure to join our Facebook group where we help entrepreneurs grow and scale their business at facebook.com/groups/SMC Mastermind, like Self-Made Coaching Mastermind. I hope you enjoy the show and be sure to subscribe and rate the show afterwards so you can get notified each Friday when we put out a new episode. Welcome to the Self-Made and Sober podcast. I'm your host, Andrew Lassise, and with me today is Lisa Smith, the author of Girl Walks Out of a Bar, and that's her memoir of her descent into and recovery from alcoholism and drug addiction. Lisa, how are you doing?
I'm great. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, I forget the source. We were talking a little beforehand that one of our previous guests had mentioned your book, and then I saw you on Instagram. Someone else had mentioned it. I think it was part of like a book club or something. So, oh, yeah. Girl Walks Out of a Bar. It's getting some rumblings. It got on my radar, and so tell me a little bit about your history and, you know, what kind of got you into the world of alcoholism and addiction?
Well, I grew up in New Jersey, in a suburb of New York City. I had a nice family. My dad was a judge. My mom was a school teacher. They were not alcoholics, but there was alcoholism and mental health challenges on both sides of their family. And I grew up, I think, like a lot of people who end up in recovery, find themselves early in life, sort of that feeling of not being comfortable in my own skin. I was like a really gloomy, sort of anxious kid. And I found out pretty young that I felt better with food, actually, which was the first substance I abused, and sugar in particular. And then I kind of graduated along the way. I always did well in school, and I ended up going to law school. And right after law school, you know, I was a big partier, but it wasn't a daily thing. It didn't impact my studies. And then after I graduated, I moved into New York City, and I had a job. I got a job at one of the giant law firms as a corporate associate, a junior associate. And it was as a first year associate that I became a nightly drinker, really to deal with, you know, not just what I know now was a genetic predisposition, as well as an underlying undiagnosed, untreated depression and anxiety disorder. But also, you know, I had that and then combined it with the crazy, stressful, exhausting life of a junior associate in a big law firm. And it was, you know, basically about a 12-year slide down that slope. And at the end, the last 18 months, you know, it was that creep, that step-by-step that we do that, you know, we justify, yeah, I know I'm drinking too much, but, you know, you would drink if you had my life. Or, you know, for me, a lot of it was, yeah, I know I shouldn't be drinking at lunch, but I can get this under control anytime. And, you know, all the crazy, silly things we say to ourselves, like, okay, yeah, I drink at lunch, but I'm doing it with other people. And also, you know, people in France drink at lunch. It's not a big deal.
They do. And who are we to judge them?
Yeah. And then finally came the, you know, and I would always justify it saying, well, I'm not one of those people who drinks in the morning. You know, that's really bad. Until the day that I woke up with like the worst hangover. And I knew I had to be in the office, and I couldn't make the tremor stop. I couldn't make the headache stop. And, you know, that was the first morning that I drank. And I remember thinking, you know, like, this is really bad, but I'm going to be able to get this under control. I'll just, you know, stop. But what ended up happening the last 18 months of my using were, instead of stopping drinking in the morning, I added cocaine in the mornings, because that way when I had a drink to relieve my hangover and my tremors and all of that, when I wouldn't get so, Okay, let me go back.
We just cut it right out.
Okay. So then one morning I woke up with the worst hangover basically of my life, and I knew I had to be in the office to be at a meeting, and I knew that the only thing that would stop me would be a drink. And you know, I remember thinking that, and that it was going to be okay because I could get it under control. But instead what I did was I added cocaine into this whole mix, so that when I had a drink in the morning to get out of bed, I also would then use some cocaine to kind of counteract the effects of the alcohol. So for people who haven't had to go through that particular misery, you know, when I would drink in the morning, I get a little bit woozy, and what cocaine did was, you know, wake me back up, make me stop slurring, make me presentable to go into the office. And so that was the last 18 months. And finally, one morning, I was on my way to work, and I just became like overcome with, you know, I thought either I had had a heart attack or I had finally overdosed, like something like that. I now know it was a panic attack. And something in that moment made me decide, you know what, I need help, and I want to live, and I need help. And I ended up checking myself into, I had to get a medicated detox for 5 days. And I ended up, I didn't know where to go. I had no sober references. My doctor helped me find just a hospital. It turned out to be like the worst psych hospital, the worst detox unit in the city. And then when I came out, I went right back to work because I didn't want to tell them. And so I went to intensive outpatient at night, and I didn't go away. I went twice a week intensive at night. And then I immediately began going to 12-step, and I got on antidepressants to appropriately treat my major depressive disorder.
So you've gone through the gambit of everything was fine, it's just a little bit on the party scene in college, and then you kind of have the justification of, well, it's not that bad. And then, you know, we can point at different cultures. It's like, well, it's acceptable in France. It's like, yeah, but you don't live in France. This is America, and it's unacceptable. Right. So you're running through the gambit of justification and, you know, other cultures, it is acceptable. And in America, it's not acceptable, but we kind of tell ourselves, well, my situation's different. And I mean, on the surface, it kind of sounds like you kind of had your stuff together. It wasn't like Lisa, the train wreck in front of other people, maybe at home.
Yeah.
It's a different story. And we do well at dressing up and putting on a good face. And I mean, you know, working at a high profile law firm and you're recently out of college, it would make sense that you've got it figured out and it's not actually a problem, because if it were a problem,
yeah,
then you wouldn't have all these other surface things. So what would you say is that, like, that moment where you were just, you had described, you check into the hospital and you go to IOP, start doing 12-step. Is it you're sober right from there, or were there struggles? What does early sobriety look like, or early first attempts?
Knock on wood, I stayed sober from there. Part of that is that I did get, you know, the right medication that was addressing a lot of what I had been, you know, kind of self-medicating. I also think, you know, I came out, and like you said, I had about 6 years into practicing law, it really became, as senior as I was getting, and I was doing well, but there was no way it was going to continue to be compatible with the amount I was drinking. And I jumped over onto the administrative side of the law firm and stopped practicing. And so it was a little bit easier. It was certainly a lot easier than if I had been in active practice to continue going down that slide. I would have been, I think, discovered much sooner if I were still practicing. But, you know, I didn't, like you said, I didn't lose everything. That was one of the things, you know, that I think also helped me stay sober, was that, you know, I came back, I had a nice apartment, I had my job, I didn't have to deal with a DUI, I didn't have to deal with, you know, having gotten fired or something like that. So
I wouldn't recommend any of those.
What?
I wouldn't recommend losing your job.
No, but it gave me like a strong basis to really kind of chase after it. And also, you know, there had been so many, I hadn't, you know, fully tried to get sober before, but for so many years, I had said, you know, I had tried myself to cut down and to do all those things. And I just, at the end, I was so exhausted. I was so sick. I was so wiped out and I was done. Like, I wanted to be done.
Now, a lot of people, they need those consequences to hit them so that they can start taking that shift and jumping into it. But you were more along the lines of you could see where it was heading and just stopped it before it actually went off track.
Well, it could have happened any day though. Like I always say, you know, people refer to people like me as having been, you know, high functioning because I held a big job and had all the outward appearances. And, you know, like I think the whole idea of being a high functioning alcoholic or addict is really a myth because you're high functioning until the day you're not, right? So I was walking into the office with cocaine on me. If I had been discovered one of those days or fallen out of my pocket and someone saw it, you know, I wouldn't be so high functioning anymore in that moment. If I had, you know, had good a point. Car crash, not so high functioning anymore, you know, missing debt, whatever it is. So
that's a really good point and interesting perspective. It's what everybody sees on the outside. And I think a lot of times people, they say that they don't give value to these surface level things, but a lot of times the surface level is actually what people are seeing and judging by.
Yeah, so, because people could say, well, Lisa really, she gets drunk a lot, but you know, I mean, she's doing well at work and whatever, so can't be a problem there. What could be wrong?
Right, it's not a problem until it's a problem, and then it's. And I know for myself, after I got sober, people were like, "Yeah, you probably should have been cutting back." And it's like no one really said anything. Like,
same here.
Minus like the obvious ones. It was like, you just like to party. You just like to work drunk. Like that's
right.
That's you. That's your thing.
Right.
So, girl walks out of a bar. What was going on before you decided to write it? Have you always wanted to write a book, or what was kind of the thought process behind that?
Well, I had always liked writing, and I think a lot of lawyers like writing, and I was like the kind of drunk who sat on a bar stool and I would be like, I'm gonna write a book, you know, and then like I got sober and wrote a book, and it was one of those things where I didn't plan it. I woke up in the mornings and I would be like so amazed that I hadn't drank the night before and so excited about that. And the story, the way it started was the story in the detox is really kind of off the rails. And for some reason, I felt like I had to memorialize that. And so I started writing it down like right away. And then I found the process of writing really cathartic in the mornings. And also I had all these family and friends being like, why didn't you tell us what's going on? What happened in the detox? And that way I could not just process it for myself, which was huge, but also hand it to them and be like, here, this is what happened. This is what it felt like. So it wasn't going to be a book by any means at the beginning. But then as I went along, I was like, this could actually like help somebody. And so I never stopped working. So I wrote at like 5 a.m. for like 10 years and I loved the process. I loved doing that. I took like, you know, I hadn't studied it in college or anything. So I started taking night classes at NYU and I started like going to writing retreats and things like that. So it was really, you know, one of those things. Some people say they find like hobbies or things or whatever in recovery, like you kind of get into something. Some people run triathlons, like that was not me. I started writing.
And so did the process start to finish take 10 years before it was published?
It really took like 12 years because the book came out in 2016. And I really started my writing process like right out of the detox, which is why I remember a lot of the details very clearly because I wrote it down like right when I got out. I also got my medical records from them, from the psych hospital. And apparently there was bingo and I was not interested in playing. I saw the nurse's notes. I was antisocial in the detox.
That's a very interesting nurse's notes. I've never been on that side of it, but I feel like but there's probably someone listening that's like, oh, she didn't play bingo. Like that's a super red flag. Like everybody knows.
It says something like patient refuses to engage with others. Patient refused to play bingo. It was in there like twice. And I was like, really? I don't remember the bingo part.
Yeah. Well, apparently
I generally like bingo.
You know what? Maybe that's one of the gifts of sobriety is that you can now participate in and enjoy bingo.
That's right. That's right.
So what has the response been to your book? Because I mean, like I said, it came across as a recommendation from a previous guest and I've seen it around. So what's been the response just overall in general?
I think I've been very fortunate that, I think it has helped people and it got a nice response when it came out. One of the big things about when it came out was it was just happened by coincidence, or there are no coincidences, I don't know, but it came out like 3 months after the American Bar Association had published a huge study on lawyers and the prevalence of substance use and mental health disorders in the profession. And the numbers were like off the charts. So there hadn't been a book like mine in the legal industry at the time. So I kind of got attached to that, that my book came out and I got attached to that. So I started speaking a lot and doing a lot of things like that. And I get involved in, there's a whole, online world of people connecting in recovery. And through that, I've really over the years, it's now been out like, more than 3 years, almost 3.5 years. And, so it's been way different than what I expected. I expected like maybe some people in my 12-step group would read it and maybe some of my friends and that would be it. So it's really been a gift.
So one of the little lines you had said in there that I'd like to dig a little deeper into, you said there are no coincidences and it was mm-hmm. kind of like that's a pretty big philosophy. I know for myself, it used to be everything is coincidence. There is no guiding force on anything. We're all going to die and nothing matters. And it's changed since I've been in recovery. So you want to elaborate a little bit on your no coincidences?
Yeah. I mean, I do believe, I had never been a religious person before, but I had always kind of had this vague notion that there was probably something, some sort of force in the universe or whatever it was. So I didn't come into recovery, with a big feeling about God or religion or anything like that. But over time I did the 12 steps and over time I really did form this belief in a higher power. For me is more like the universe is kind of a force. And the idea that there are no coincidences, when I think about it, I think about all of the times that I was wandering around New York City in a blackout. Like, how did I not get killed? How did I not get arrested? How did awful things not happen? How did I not just like step in front of a cab at 3 a.m. one morning in a blackout? All these things that should have happened. I should have lost my job. I should have had all these things happen. Didn't. And I've been fortunate in coming through on the other side. I've been very fortunate in my recovery. And I think, that basically what struck with me was I'm supposed to be out here. I do feel like I have a life purpose now, which is helping the next person. And I feel like the book, in that sense, there are no coincidences, meaning that there's a reason for stuff. And, not like I believe we are predetermined. I don't think it's not like I think we have no free will. But I think that, when the universe sort of has a plan, it can happen.
Yeah, I'm in the same boat with you. And one of the things that a lot of times you'll see in 12-step recovery, it'll be the low bottom drunks who have lost everything, who have tried everything and last stop. And you'll also see people come in and out a lot, and they'll try it, things will get better, they'll disappear, come back and forth, back and forth. So your experience of not losing everything and your experience of trying it your first go and still, like you said, knock on wood, continue doing what you're doing, keep getting what you're getting. But did you feel sort of like your situation was kind of special and unique, kind of like when you were drinking with, well, if your situation were like mine, then you would drink the way I do? Is it, well, if you had as much to lose as I did, then you would be as sober as I am?
Right. Well, maybe, I don't know. I mean, I feel like it is, you know, what I stay really cognizant of, I think, is that the day I stop thinking, you know, I can, or the day I start thinking I can coast in my recovery, or the day I don't remember how important it is for me to do all the things I need to do to stay sober for today, is the day it all goes away. I do think in recovery, like as anybody puts together one day after another day, you know, the days stack up and think, you know, good things do tend to happen. And so that's not always enough, but I'm just going to keep doing this. And I've always been very much like just for today, total one day at a time person.
And what are some of the things that you do just for today on if you gave yourself a gold star and you hit all of the things, what would that look like?
If I hit all of the things, I would get up. Well, I do one thing I do every day that I've been doing since literally the day that I got out of the detox is, you know, when I was at my bottom, when I was so miserable and so spent, I used to like open my eyes in the morning and I would be like, fuck, like I woke up again. Like, I don't want to do this again. I don't want to be me again. And so my thinking, my thought when I wake up, and it was even before I did work on higher power stuff, I wake up and I look up and I'm like, thank you. That's all I say. I'm just like, thank you. Like, I realize right away, oh my gosh, I didn't drink yesterday. I get a chance at another day. On a perfect day, I would then meditate. I would then go to a 12-step meeting. I would spend a lot of my time, you know, doing sort of trying to help the next person. The biggest thing for me that has, you know, I mean, built up my recovery has been service and being counted on and showing up for other people. Like, I think, you know, the hardest thing and also the best thing I did in recovery was help my dad in his final days when he was dying of cancer. And, you know, that is the most important thing I've ever done, because I was able to be there and do that and take the lead. And, you know, those things don't happen otherwise.
And while you were out drinking, would that not have been the case?
Oh, no way. I would have been sitting in a bar crying about the fact that my dad was dying and not being there. And I adored him. It would have been totally different. So everything was about me. You know, now I get to make it about somebody else, and it's huge.
And that's exactly where I was going. I was thinking for myself, it was very much, I used to only focus on what I could get out of every situation.
Oh yeah.
How I could manipulate something so that I could screw other people over so that I could get the upper hand. And it never really worked out how I wanted it to. And then like I switch it over to focusing on service, and then opportunities just knock down my door, things that I never could have scripted, could have planned out, life beyond my wildest dreams.
Totally.
Like when I had started my IT company, my initial goal was to generate $30,000 in 1 year by having 200 customers. And like at our peak, we had 25,000 customers and did close to 5 million in revenue. And it's
Whoa. It's like,
if I had gotten what I think I wanted, I would have cut myself real, real low.
Yeah.
But
yeah, right.
Open to that, because year one, in the same example, we only had like maybe 50, 60 clients. So it was like, I didn't hit the thing that I think that I wanted, but I kept striving for it. And then you know, you unlock one thing and it was random. I'm at a 12-step meeting and a guy is wearing a Ravens hoodie in Florida. And I'm like, okay, well, nobody wears hoodies in Florida. So clearly this guy is new. I talk to him. I'm like, hey, I like your hoodie. I'm from Baltimore. He's like, cool. I'm from Baltimore too. And I'm like, cool. I'm going to sponsor you now. And he ended up being one of my best friends, someone who helped me grow the company a huge way. And it's just like these little nothings. Yeah. And that moment could have just as easily been, I noticed he was wearing a hoodie and just kept living my life. And like, I look at that moment and how extremely different things turned out as a result of helping him. That wasn't my intention. It wasn't, what if this guy's the guy?
What if this guy can, right.
But it was.
No, that's what, yeah, that's like no coincidence, right? Because you were sober and there to show up for it, you know, something happens.
So do you have any examples in your life where something just kind of a random coincidence, godsidence, seemed like nothing that kind of just turned into something huge in your life?
Yeah, I mean, with my book, for sure, there was, you know, I happened to be in this writing workshop and somebody in my writing workshop was friendly with, you know, some agent. So I followed her on Twitter, a book agent. And so I just asked, like, who is that? And so I followed her on Twitter and she put on her Twitter something about a contest for a book deal with a small publisher, like a writing retreat in Vermont was having this contest where you could win a book deal with the publisher. And I was like, you know what? It's the right time. I've been writing this book for 10 years. I need to like drill down, submit a manuscript and see what happens. And that was, I ended up winning that contest. And that was how I got my deal with my publisher. But if I just hadn't been, when I heard him say, oh yeah, this agent on Twitter, if I hadn't been like, okay, now I'm going to follow that agent. Now I'm going to follow, you know, this. It's a lot. It's much easier to be in the right place at the right time when you're sober than it ever was before.
Yeah. And I think also maybe even in the past, like if you were right place, right time, you don't have the opportunities play out in your favor as often just because when we're selfish and only focusing on what can I get out of the situation, what's the easy way for me to take as opposed to what's the correct way for me to take, what's the way that is most service, most beneficial, what can I look into? For me, it was a lot of, you know, I lose my job and it's like, okay, well, I'll just go get another one and wherever I end up, like, cool, what's this job for? Okay, here I am. I hate everything. Everything sucks. The world keeps happening to me.
Right.
And then I see on completely flip side when I basically like challenge 12-step recovery and I'm like, I know this isn't going to work, but here we go. I'll turn my will and my life over. I'm going to end up interviewing at this place. I don't know what they do. Oh, you happen to do IT? Oh, that's funny because that's what I've been trying to do for the last 10 years. And oh, and you're hiring immediately now? Oh, okay.
Yeah, great. Right. It's like that.
And you pay 20% more than I was willing to take? Oh, okay. And just things stacking on top of each other over and over.
Yeah.
And I kept winning. And it basically got to the point that you know, I didn't like the whole higher power thing, but like, I just kept winning. It kept working. And I stopped questioning whether or not that there was any science behind why this is or isn't working. And it's just like, if I keep winning when I play this game, then I'm just going to keep doing it because I don't know why I keep winning, but is a lot better than trying to manipulate my way to win a game that I hate playing to begin with. It's just
right. Right. No, you're totally right. It's true. And you know, I look back and from the very beginning when I would wake up in the morning and be like, you know, as soon as I had, I remember, I think it was like when I hadn't drank for like 7 days, I'm like, 7 days? How did that happen? And I remember thinking, how did I do that? And then as I got into 12 step, I, you know, came to believe like the fact as it was, you know, months in, I'm like, there is no way Lisa on her own doesn't drink for, you know, 2 months. It doesn't happen that way. So I feel like I'm getting some sort of help from the universe if I show up and do all the right things.
Yeah, I've found, I seem to find that a lot of people, and you can tell that you're one of those people that they would say like is on the beam and is active in 12-step recovery and practices the principles in all your affairs and you know, all those cryptic cliches without saying what it is, but like everybody listening knows what it is, but you know, following the traditions. But you know, when you apply that in your life, I've just found that it just makes things easier and things
so much easier
work, and nobody gets mad. I don't have people getting angry at me if I make a tough decision based on integrity.
Yeah.
I don't get the kind of backlash that I used to when I would lie and steal and try to manipulate. Like, that would get me backlash and I'd get the results that I think I wanted. And on the other side, there have been times where I've thrown away gigantic opportunities, air quotes.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's, this would be a huge win financially, however, at the expense of integrity.
Right.
But I justify it because I'd provide jobs with it.
Yeah.
You know, things like that. But then turning those down, and then as a result of turning it down, news getting out that I made the integrity decision to turn down this road. And because I did that, something 10 times bigger and better falls into my lap that I don't even have to do anything for. They're just like, this is yours. I can tell by the type of person you are that this will just work out. So tell us the terms. It's yours. And it's like, well, that was way easier than the thing that I think that I wanted, but it's so difficult when you're in it.
Oh my gosh.
To make decisions like that, because you don't know on the other side, oh, don't worry, so-and-so is going to hear about this.
It's going to be okay. Yeah, but I never trusted that if I stopped drinking, it was going to be okay. Life was going to be okay, let alone better, you know, let alone good things happening. I was like, well, I don't know what people do if they don't drink. I don't want to be one of those people.
It's crazy because it's like, it keeps getting better and better. And it's just like,
yeah,
life never kept getting better, but my life would get, maybe like I'd have a good week and then it's just like, okay, when's it going to crash? And it was like, after a couple months, it was like, why does my life keep getting better than it used to be over and over and over? Like, when does this wear off? But it's kind of like, you know, if you're putting deposits into a savings account and if you just keep adding to it over and over and not taking withdrawals, it doesn't really matter how you feel about the situation.
Right.
You just keep adding to it, it keeps getting higher. And as long as you don't take those withdrawals and don't, you know, take your will back, which easier said than done. It's easy on a podcast to say,
right,
I've never made a decision based on self and all
sober.
But it always seems that whenever something doesn't go my way, my preference, it usually has something tied to it with making a decision based on self, a decision based on a short-term win versus a long-term investment. Mm-hmm. And that's really what 12 Steps teaches you, is that it's not about getting those short-term wins and whatever you think that you want in this moment, but it's a lot more of, let it happen how it's supposed to happen, because trust me, it keeps getting better. But it's very difficult when you've got decades of it not getting better to hear that the only fun part of your life, stopping doing that, is what will actually make life better.
Yeah, you have to be, I mean, for me at least, I was so miserable, like nothing could have been worse. than where I was. I was that miserable. I was that sick. I was that exhausted. I was like, anything is better than this. I had what, you know, we refer to as the gift of desperation.
I think your situation is cool because you had the gift of desperation without the obvious reasons for having to do it. You had the surface things, and that's just very rare. And that was my experience as well, which is very cool because it's not the norm.
Right.
It's usually not you come into recovery while still having your job and things are just better as a result. It's usually you've been, you know, they talk about being beaten into a state of reasonableness, and it's just like, your life is terrible. Stop doing life this way.
Right. Right. Yeah.
Having that perspective and being open-minded to it, that's such a key.
Yeah. Well, to me, it's like, it sounds like it was a high bottom, but it was really a low bottom because I hated myself so much. I was so like dead inside, you know. It was just, you know, and like I said, it was a matter of time. I could have gone into work that day instead of checking in, and I could have been arrested. You know, I mean, it was an accident waiting to happen. And it was just amazing that it did not.
Well, it's great that you caught it before it happened. And then, you know, all the blessings that have happened in your life as a result of it. And Lisa, I want to be conscious of time, but where can people find out more about you and where can they get your book?
Oh, sure. Thank you. My website, I actually now have launched a consultancy for lawyers and law firms and legal organizations on these issues. And so my website is LisaSmithAdvisory with an O.com. Or you can Google Lisa Smith author. Lisa Smith author also works. My book is on Amazon. It's in Barnes and Noble. It's around. It's on Kindle, and there's an Audible book of it too. So
it's everywhere, and we'll be sure to have show notes with links to all that. Lisa, it was great having you on the show, and to everybody great listening, you enjoyed the episode. Please rate and subscribe. Leave us a comment, leave us a review. Really appreciate it. It's how we grow the show. And have a great day, Lisa. Thank you so much.
You too. Thanks so much. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much for listening to Self-Made and Sober. Be sure to join our Facebook group at facebook.com/groups/SMC Mastermind, like Self-Made Coaching Mastermind. I hope you enjoyed the show, and be sure to subscribe and rate the show so you can get notified each Friday when we put out a new episode.